You're listening to a message from Gateway Church Geelong. We hope it blesses you. For more information about Gateway, visit gc.org.au.
Are you ready for the word this morning? Okay, let's turn to John chapter 4. This morning, I want to talk about my word from John chapter 4 about the woman of Samaria. But I want to talk about five areas that I really want to look towards, and that is connection from this story, authenticity, worthiness, vulnerability, and the courage of the people within the story. Today, I also want to show you a study that was performed on people and how their worthiness makes a difference. So let's turn to the Word of God this morning, John chapter 4, verse 7 from the New American Standard. There came a woman of Samaria to draw water. Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink," for his disciples had gone away into the city to buy food. Therefore, the Samaritan woman said to him, "How is it that you, being a Jew, ask me for a drink since I am a Samaritan woman? For Jews have no dealings with Samaritans." Jesus answered and said to her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it says to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water." She said to him, "Sir, you have nothing to draw with, and the well is so deep. Where then do you get that living water?" Jesus answered and said to her, "Everyone who drinks of this water will thirst again. But whoever drinks of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst. But the water that I will give him will become in him a well of water springing up to eternal life." The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water so I will not be thirsty nor come all the way here to draw." You see, this was a story where we can see the weariness of Jesus. His disciples had gone into the marketplace to buy food, but Jesus was staying by a well. But it's incredible that even when you're tired, even when you're weary, it is the grace which gives you the ability for a chosen task that God would have you to do. Even though he was weary and tired, he was listening to his Father and knew exactly the woman of the well that was coming towards him. You see, this woman was so surprised because he did not show anger of his own nation against the Samaritans. There was a divide. There was anger against each other. Jews couldn't talk or mix with Samaritans. But here you see Jesus going against current culture to reach out in his authenticity to reveal the power of God to her. And one other question is that she came with many waters of comfort. And one question I want you to go in with this message today: what are your waters of comfort? When challenges come to your life, where is it that you lean to? What is it that you draw upon? What are your waters of comfort? Are they sustaining you? Are they propelling you? Are they giving you peace? Are they giving you courage this morning? Because Jesus is talking about not comforts of water in this world, but he's talking about living water that resides within you, Jesus Christ in you this morning. The first area I want to look at is connection in this story. You know, connection is the ability to feel connected, a relationship in which a person is linked with someone else. You know, we can have relatives. I can have a cousin and I'm linked to my cousin, or I'm linked to my auntie. But that can be a total surface relationship. That can be a connection just because they're my relative. But what Jesus is talking about is having a connection that goes beyond surface, that goes beyond just the outside appearance and going in something deeper. Connection is the ability to feel connected. You know, there is a line in this song that I've heard that goes, "I've seen many searching for answers far and wide, but I know we're all searching for only answers you provide." You see, there is plenty of information that is continually available to us in our world. many paths we make choices be on, but truth, God's truth, is where we need to make decisions, because God's truth is the road in any wilderness that we face, and His truth sets us free to see the rivers in the deserts of our lives. In Isaiah 43:19, it says, "Behold, I will do something new." Now it will. It doesn't say it might not. It doesn't say maybe next year. It says now it will spring forth. Will you not be aware of it? Think about that statement that's being said there. Will you not be aware of what God is springing forth in your life? I will even make a roadway in the wilderness. I will make rivers in the desert. You know, my questions, my thoughts over the last 6 months have constantly been, why do some people see the roads, and why do others only see and experience the wilderness? Why do some experience deserts, but others are in the rivers while in the desert? To have information allows you to navigate your own life. It helps you to make your own choices. It also allows life at times to navigate you. But the truth is the Word of God, who is Jesus. He is the way, He is the truth, and He is the life. Therefore, information is not all that we need. If you want to see and experience the road in the wilderness and see the rivers in the desert, we need truth to navigate us, and the truth is Jesus Christ. We need a way in which comes from Jesus. You see, information can be so tricky at times, as it's not always undergirded by truth. To walk in truth comes through connection and belief in our God. Connection is why we are here. Connection gives incredible purpose and meaning to our lives. It is the ability to feel connected, and Jesus is here to grace you with that ability to feel and receive connection from Him. Jesus this morning, Jesus in your lifetime, is here to connect with you. I see in this story the connection within the woman. You know, this woman's vulnerability astounds me. Many husbands, many separations, yet she's still moving forward to love again. You know, the one thing that keeps us out of connection is our fear that we are not worthy of connection. And I see Jesus wanted to connect with her. He extended vulnerability, not controlled by culture or custom. He wasn't controlled that she was a woman or a Samaritan. He was searching for her. Who sits at a well with nothing to draw the well from the water with? He used a human exchange to reveal truth to her. The water you need for your body must be sought over and over to meet the reoccurring physical want. But Jesus said this statement to the woman, "Everyone who drinks of this water will thirst again. However, there is an inner, never-failing source." Jesus said, "But whoever drinks of the water that I will give him shall never thirst. But the water that I will give him will become in him a well of water springing to eternal life." His connection to her was revealing her whole life. She was searching for connection, continually drawing from a well in the natural that made her continually thirst and thirst that was never being quenched. But Jesus, in His grace and mercy, was revealing a spiritual well that met the very fabric of her being, revealing the Father, revealing love, revealing joy, revealing answers. Connection is the ability to feel connected. Connection like she had never understood was happening right in front of her eyes. The second area I want to look at is authenticity. The quality of being authentic. This is something that you need to choose. It's a practice that we need to walk in. In the culture that we live in, being authentic is more vital than ever before. And if I look at the authenticity of Jesus Christ, there is such power in who He is. You know, before he even came to Samaria, before Jesus even sat at this well, he was at Judea. And I see an incredible mark of authenticity on the life of Jesus Christ here. In John chapter 4 from the Message verses 1 to 3, it says, Jesus realized that the Pharisees were keeping count of the baptisms that he and John performed, although his disciples, not Jesus, did the actual baptizing. So here's the Pharisees, here's the men of law there, the religious leaders. There's all these crowds, there's all these baptisms happening. And they're starting to keep score. Well, did you see on Facebook today? There's 17 likes. No, it's 23 likes. No, it's 40 likes. Instagram is going mad. I can't believe it. The disciples are just baptizing. They're just up there. They're over 100 now. But no, Jesus is doing more. No, the disciples are doing more. And you can see that the Pharisees are keeping score. Keeping score so much, they are blinded by actual reality of what's in front of them. Jesus was never baptizing. It was John and the disciples that were doing the baptizing. They had posted the score that Jesus was ahead, turning him and John into rivals in the eyes of the people. So Jesus left the Judean countryside and went back to Galilee. But to get there, he had to pass through Samaria. You know, we live in a culture of comparison. We live in communities of keeping score. But when we live in that culture, when we start to work into that culture, when we start to react out of that culture by comparison, by keeping score, it has the ability to stop seeing clearly what is right in front of you. It can distort the image of true reality. But what I love about Jesus is that authenticity breaks the culture of comparison. Authenticity keeps you on track. He didn't stay in that culture of comparison. He didn't stay where they were doing the baptize. Jesus actually left. And the question I had to ask myself when there are crowds, when there's all this spiritual activity, when people are getting baptized, all amazing things, what is it that I would do when culture is bringing keeping score and comparisons? Would I stay or would I go? But Jesus, in his authenticity, says, I'm not going to stay in that culture of keeping score. I'm not going to stay in that culture of comparison. I'm going to leave and see what my Father has me to do. In Proverbs 4:12, it says, your progress, listen to this scripture, your progress will have no limits for those who walk according to God, for those who come along with me. Jesus's progress was not limited. It was broken through the power of his authenticity to be real to his Father, to leave the culture of comparison and keeping score, to say, God, not my will be done, but God, where is it that you want me to go? And that's what led him to the woman of Samaria. Authenticity, vulnerability to be who you were created to be, keeps you on track with God. The Bible says, let your speech always be with grace, as though seasoned with salt, so that you will know how to respond to each person. Jesus had a message in his heart. It wasn't for the crowds who loved comparison, who wanted to keep score and alter the message. It was for hearts seeking truth. What is the message in your heart this morning? When we talk to people, what is the message that comes from our heart? Is it one of authenticity, one of grace, one of connection? Can we leave the place of comparison, keeping score, having the last word, and stay true to Jesus and who he has created us to be? If research shows us that we are more polarized at this moment than we have ever been before in the place of history, more divided than we have ever been, less likely to compromise, what do we make of this? You see, I perceive an epidemic sweeping our generation that we have the answer to. It's not just a conversation, but it is the power of connection to Jesus Christ and authenticity that comes from the Spirit of God that is already within you. Knowing who you are in God and to walk in His ways with the incredible help of the Holy Spirit. Through us, He will dispel comparison. Through us, He will dispel keeping score in this generation. If you seek connection but don't know how, the Holy Spirit is your biggest guide to the library of truth and answers you will ever need. Authenticity keeps you on track with an incredible truth that you belong to Him. The third thing I want to look at is worthiness. You know, a sense of worthiness is a strong sense of love and belonging. A sense of deserving. Did this woman have this? Did she feel that she deserved love, belonging, and connection? Or was she disconnected? She couldn't get water from her local well, but had to travel a great distance. This doesn't rate high of belonging or having access to resource or community. You see, we all find ourselves in times of wilderness and seasons of deserts. So who sees the rivers and who sees the roads? A study was carried out at the level of personal worthiness between two groups of people. One group identified as having a strong sense of love and belonging. The other group identified struggling with the mindset with, were they good enough? Were they worthy? Did they deserve love and a strong sense of belonging? So what was the difference between these two groups? The difference between them, the ones who didn't struggle believed that they were worthy of love and belonging. The group of people that did struggle didn't feel like they were good enough. They believed that they were unworthy. The one thing that can keep us out of connection is our fear that we are not worthy of connection. It is also an inability to receive love. The amount of people that I talk to that find it so hard to receive a compliment. The amount of people that I have coffee with that find it so hard to receive encouragement, they shy away, they hide their faces, they change the conversation. Holy Spirit, help us, teach us to learn how to receive goodness from our God. Help us to receive your encouragement that builds up and edifies the body of Christ to be the very expression of Jesus Christ on this earth. You know, a sense of worthiness is a strong sense of love and belonging. The thing that I see here is even though there will be times in the wilderness, this Samaritan woman was searching for the dirt road, the path in her desert. She was looking for a river. The road is direction. In a wilderness without a road, without direction, confusion and feeling can be your reality. Your word, God says in Psalm 119, verse 105, your word is a lamp. Your word is a lamp to guide my feet and to light my path. In a desert without a river, there is nothing to quench your thirst or sustain you. The river is living water that gives you life. In a desert of depression, His Spirit shows you the river of a renewed mind and joy. In a desert of depression, and I speak to minds here this morning, in a desert of depression that is over your mind, His Spirit shows you the river of a renewed mind and joy. In a wilderness of stubbornness to your breakthrough, walking around in circles, what you thought would only take 11 days took so much longer. But He shows you the road that brings protection. He shows you the road that brings you direction and lights your way to victory. In a desert of a lack of intimacy, struggled marriages, His Spirit shows you the river of refreshing within your marriage. Renewed intimacy, strength to marriages, strength to your relationships. In a wilderness of lack on confusion, hope deferred. His Spirit shows you the well of living water that shows you clearly truth, that sets you free and reveals that your feet are on a solid foundation, who is Jesus Christ. Don't be afraid of the wildernesses. Don't be afraid of being in the wilderness. Don't be afraid of the deserts, because this is where he shows you the roads and the rivers. Don't be afraid of the wilderness. We all comes into times where we're feeling the challenges and it feels like a desert. Don't be afraid. This is the very place that God shows you your road in your wilderness, and he lights up the river in your desert, where God becomes strong on your behalf. Everyone who drinks of this water will thirst again. But whoever drinks of the water that I will give him shall never thirst. But the water that I will give him will become in him a well of water springing up to eternal life. You know, in this woman of Samaria, I see a sense of worthiness. She felt a sense that she deserved more. She kept trying and searching for what she still didn't have. She was looking for love, a deep sense of belonging, connection, and authenticity. His word this morning lights up the path and makes the road in the wilderness. A wilderness holds darkness and high trees, yet today he makes a clearing for you. In a desert, it can be dry, mirages, things you think are present, but the closer you think you're getting to it, the further it seems to go away. This is why information. Hear my heart. This is why information is not enough for our lives as believers of Jesus Christ. You must draw from his deep, vast, endless source of truth. The water, this is what Jesus says, the water I give to you will be an artesian spring within, gushing. Not trickling, not here and there, stop, start. He says it'll be gushing fountains of endless life within you. You will be sustained greater in a desert if you have God's living water, living truth that sets information free, trust over confusion, peace over disturbances in our mind. The woman says to Jesus, "Where then do you get this living water from?" You know, I thought about this and I thought, well, this is really sustainable living at an all-time high, and all the greenies will love that. The potential in a question. I can be funny. The potential in a question. The potential of searching out truth. Let me tell you, don't ever underestimate searching for God's truth. Don't stay in the place of information or feelings. Please don't underestimate seeking out the truth of God's word. Not being complacent with the waters of comfort around us, but searching for a living, eternal, endless truth. A continual, not I searched for God back there for an answer. It's a continual searching for God's truth in our answers for our marriages, answers in our relationships, answers for our children, answers for sickness. It's a continual journey of seeking God's truth. Fourthly, vulnerability. Vulnerability, which we all are challenged by, is no easy feat at times. Vulnerability is appearing as you are. This incredible sense of vulnerability to appear as you are. You know, this same study on this group of people who found they had a deep sense of worthiness. What did this group have in common with each other? What they found was that they were living wholeheartedly, living with sincerity and commitment, unshakable, enthusiastic, constant, and loyal. You know, when I see the meaning of this word, I see the Holy Spirit. Loyal, constant, unshakable, dedicated, and devoted to you. The Holy Spirit searches for you, just like Jesus was searching for the woman at the well to tell her search was over. What she was looking for was right in front of her. Don't ever underestimate that God today searches for you. This study revealed that from living vulnerable, living wholeheartedly, living from a sense of worthiness, revealed a pattern in these people, and it was courage. What they had in common was a sense of courage. Jesus showed immense courage to leave the culture of comparison, culture of keeping score to follow his Father. The woman showed immense courage to be vulnerable to Jesus when he asked her a personal question and she revealed her life to him truthfully. She showed vulnerability to ask Jesus for his living water, and her courage made her see the truth. And lastly, courage. Courage is the strength in the face of pain or grief. The ability to do something that frightens one, bravery, as Victoria comes. You know, the root word for courage in Latin is cor. It actually means heart. The definition was to tell the story of who you are with your whole heart. The courage to be imperfect. The courage to love ourselves first. The courage to be authentic, which was so hard, but it was this that gave them connection from this study. They were willing to let go of who they were, of who they thought they should be, in order to be who they were. The other thing they had in common is they fully embraced vulnerability. They believed that what made them vulnerable made them beautiful. They didn't talk about vulnerability being comfortable, nor did they talk about it being excruciating. They just talked about it being necessary. They talked about the willingness to say, I love you first. The willingness to do something where there are no guarantees. They thought this was fundamental. You know, we all have times in our lives, times where we have experienced deserts, times where we have experienced wilderness, whether it was in our control or out of our control. But in these times is where God wants to talk to you. You know, to see the road and the river, sometimes the pain of the desert must be confronted. To see the roads and to see the rivers in pain, sometimes we must face the pain of the deserts and the wilderness. But when Jesus comes to talk to you about those pains, he also comes to heal you, restore you, and set you free. Whenever the Holy Spirit comes, it's never a confrontation of the negative. It's always a confrontation of the positive, because he's coming to heal you. He's not coming to bring up your pain, to make you talk about it so you feel more pain. He's coming to you to bring up the pain, to lead it to restoration and healing within your life, because Jesus actually desires us to live pain-free. Jesus actually desires us to live in his supernatural ability. You know, vulnerability at times has pushed me, but we need to push it back. I didn't win, but I won my life back. This was a statement that this lady said who was doing the study. When she was going all through this, she started to see her deserts and she started to see her wilderness. And vulnerability pushed against her, but she pushed back on it. She didn't win it that day, but she won her life back. So what were Jesus' words to the woman? It says, it's who you are. Think about what Jesus is saying. Here is the answer for us today. We are the same people at the well asking these same questions at the time. God, I need your living water. I'm in a desert. God, I need to see my road because I'm in a wilderness. I can't see clearly. So what is the words of Jesus to you today? It's who you are and the way you live that counts before God. Your worship must engage your spirit in the pursuit of truth. That's the kind of people the Father is looking out for. Those who are simply and honestly themselves before Him in their worship. God is sheer being itself, spirit. Those who worship Him must do it out of their very being, their spirits, their true selves in adoration. The woman said, I don't know about that. I do know that the Messiah is coming. When he arrives, we'll get the whole story. And Jesus said, I am he, says Jesus. You don't have to wait any longer or look any further. I am here. Let's bow our heads this morning and close our eyes.